Lord, we want to thank you for a wonderful morning that you've brought us as a family together. And thank you that we have the privilege once again to be here on a Sunday morning to listen to your word. Lord, to listen to words that is inspired by your spirit. And Lord, to receive more and more of your love, your grace, and your revelation. Oh Lord, my mind's been upon that thought about the rock of revelation and how you're building a church on that. And Lord, I'm thankful to be a part of that this morning. Thank you, Lord, that you guard us. Thank you, Lord, that you keep us in your hands. Thank you, Lord, that we can come to you and kneel at your feet and, Lord, just pour back love towards you. We are thankful for everything that we have. We are content with everything that we have, Lord. Thank you that our wishes and our desires are not for things of this world, Lord, but for heavenly things. And Lord, thank you that no matter where we find ourselves, no matter where we are in our journey, we know that you have been where we are going and you've seen where we are going, and we will trust you regardless of how we feel, Lord. Because like Job did, Lord, we will put our trust in you fully. Help us to stand steadfast in that belief. Make our hearts, Lord, at peace. Give us rest. And thank you for an awesome, awesome family that we can share this journey with. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die? Could he devote that sacred hit for such a one as I? At the cross, when I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart pulled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
In my life, at the cross I saw the light, amen. And the burden of my heart rolled away, amen. Now we're going to sing Sweet By and By now, but we're going to change it to the way we sing it usually. So instead of going, in the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In that sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. So we're not going to hang on that note. We're going to carry on straight through. All right? There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father
reveal.
broken. My heart is open. You've given me a brand new song. With utmost thanksgiving and heaven is singing. With utmost thanksgiving, my freedom claims. Now everything's open. All these chains broken. There's nothing evil holding me. My prison was a lie, the devil I denied. I'm free, yes, I'm free to walk with God. Now everything's open. All these chains broken. You are my freedom. You are my freedom. You're everything I live for. You have come and removed these chains. Yes, yes, you are my freedom. You're everything I live for. Everything's changed when you came. Yes, you are. Nothing evil.
up my cross, I knew that I would follow an everlasting God that would never fail me and that I can walk with until the end of this age and the beginning of the everlasting life. Thank you, Lord, that we can trust in you.
Yes, Father.
When we fail in ourselves, we know that we can trust in you. Oh, glory. We love you, Lord. Amen. Broken every single thing that has kept us in bondage. Lord, there are some of us that are experiencing tremendous struggles, tremendous pain. But Lord, you are bigger than that. You are bigger than that. Thank you.
Father. Aren't you glad you have a Heavenly Father?
Hallelujah.
I have a Father. He calls me His own. And He'll never leave me. No matter where I go. Gracious Lord, how thankful we can say we have a Father. What a Father you are, Lord. No one beside you, Lord.
Amen.
Praise your great name.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, we can say we came out of you. Lord, that your life is in us. Lord, because the Son, the Father's life is always in His children. We thank you, Lord, by a new birth. We can say it's no longer I that lives, but Christ that lives in me.
Hallelujah.
How thankful we are. We can say, our God which art in heaven, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as in heaven. Lord, may you be glorified this morning. Lord, may your will be done. Lord, in our lives. Lord, we don't want our will. We know our will and your will cannot operate in the same place. Lord, one must be dead. We know we must lay our will down. Father, your will can be done. We want to see your will done, Lord, that you'd be glorified and everything said and done, Lord. Father, Lord, we're just asking you'll be with us now. Anoint speaker and hearer one more time. Father, meet every need. Guide us in your word. Lord, may you just have preeminence in this service. Lord, may it lose human control. Lord, from the front to the back. Lord, may you anoint each one. Granted, Almighty God, we thank you for this opportunity to be gathered with saints of like precious faith, with ones we're going to spend eternity with. Praise your holy name, O God. Father, we just pray you would be with us now. Lord, in Jesus Christ's name. Father, we especially want to ask you to bring comfort to the Oliver family. Lord, as you called your son home, we thank you for his life that he lived. Thank you, Lord, his work, Lord, your work, your committed him to do, Lord, lives on in his family, Lord, in Africa as well, Lord. Father, I pray you would bless him, Lord. We're so glad he's in a place that he can never be sad. He can never be down. He can never be sick. Lord, he can never be wandering, Lord. All he can do is rejoice and shout. Lord, he's, what a great place. Father, we're so thankful you carried him there. It wasn't his ability. Lord, you carried him there. Lord, we're under expectation one day you'll take us there as well.
Amen.
Father, if we're alive or if we pass from this mortal life, Lord, you'll take us there.
Amen.
Lord, we're so glad, Father, that, Lord, this life is but a vapor.
Yes.
Lord, but there's an eternal life that's already in these souls of ours.
Hallelujah.
Lord, you've quickened us unto eternal life.
Hallelujah.
We thank you, Lord, we cannot perish no more than you can perish.
Amen.
Lord, this body's just a house we live in. It's just a temporary dwelling place. Lord, we're so glad that's the truth. We have an eternal one in the heavens. We praise your holy name, O God. Lord, we just commit the service into your hands in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you, musicians. Thank you, Brother John. Amen. God bless you all. Praise the Lord. If you've got your Bibles handy, if you'd like to turn with me to Isaiah 53. Amen. Truly, Brother Richard was he's a man of God. Because he's not was, he is.
Amen.
Amen. He's a real hero of the faith.
Amen.
Amen. His memorial service is this coming Friday up in Eltham. Amen. He's a real servant of the Lord. It's good to have everyone here today. It's Brother John's birthday today as well. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Amen. And John and Annalise, they renovated the church beautifully. Amen. Who thinks they did a good job? Amen. Thank you very much for your work and inspiration. Amen. Really appreciate that. Amen. Let's just go to Isaiah 53. That's a very familiar piece of scripture to us all. Okay. 53 and verse 1. It says, "Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed?" Amen. It's revealed to those who believe the report. That's you. "For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, that when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and we hid it, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he is bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand." Amen. Now let's go to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1, we're reading verse 12. Is giving thanks unto the Father, which has made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins, who is the firstborn of the invisible, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn in every creature. For by him are all things created, that in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things are created by him and for him, and he is before all things, and by him all things consist. He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. Amen. May the Lord bless his word. You may have your seats this morning. I want to kind of continue our thought about being united with Christ and how he has as Paul would say in the book of Ephesians, and we read it last Sunday, that we have a husband and wife are one flesh, and he says, "Great is the mystery, speaking of Christ and his church." And we read there in Isaiah 53 of a man. And Brother Branham would look at a replica of Michelangelo's statue of Moses. And he was in the Forest Lawn Cemetery there in America, and he saw this replica of this statue, and he was amazed by the statue, because there was a mark on its knee, and he heard about the history of the statue, where Michelangelo, he spent many years making this statue of Moses, and he and he had in his mind exactly what Moses would look like, and you know, he's trying to portray his character in the statue, and you know, like many great sculptors or artists, they receive an inspiration and they begin to put that inspiration into a statue or a painting or maybe even a song or yeah, but the main thing is that their inspiration that was in their mind becomes manifested. And God in his great mind, he had the idea of what the perfect man should be like. And we see him down through the Old Testament. You know, he was, we have in the garden, we have the perfect man and the perfect woman. And Brother Bram says that was God's masterpiece family. It was the pinnacle of creation there. But then Satan, he got under the walls of the Word of God that was to protect them. And he marred the masterpiece, but you know, because he brought sin into creation. But God is not willing to be defeated. Amen. And he wasn't willing just to leave his masterpiece fallen and broken on the soil, but he began to rebuild his masterpiece. Amen. And he would begin to anoint people's lives down through the ages, and he would begin to portray that masterpiece. He would portray him in Abraham. Amen. He would portray him as Isaac, as the promised son. Amen. As the lamb that was provided. You know, he would portray him in Joseph, in the life of Joseph, of being, you know, that coat of many colors. You know, his father was inspired to give him that coat, because we understand a covenant in the scripture. You know, God gave Noah, a rainbow covenant, you know, many colors. And so in Joseph, he was typifying now this coat the father gives the covenant to the son. And also he was spiritual. You know, his brothers weren't spiritual. And they hated him without a cause. And they, you know, sold him into slavery. And he went down into Egypt. And he was there. And eventually he would end up in prison. And, you know, in Pharaoh's prison. And there was the, you know, one of the prisoners was saved. And the other one was condemned. Just like Jesus on the cross. One thief was pardoned. The other one went to hell. And but then after that, he ascended on high. And then he was on the right hand of Pharaoh. That you had to get through Joseph in order to get to Pharaoh himself. It's the same as our Lord Jesus Christ. And now, but then also, during that time in Egypt, when he came into that place, he was higher than any other name in the kingdom apart from just under Pharaoh. He married a Gentile bride. Amen. Amen. He married a Gentile bride. And then as the pressure came on his brothers to come and find grain, you know, finally it came to a point where all of his brothers were there. Benjamin was now there, and he couldn't withhold himself anymore. And he, you know, speaking of when, you know, the 144,000 are now in the land, and he couldn't, you know, he appeared as a Gentile to his brothers. They didn't understand who he was. But then he sent everyone from him, and his wife was up in the palace, and then he revealed himself to his brethren. Amen. Speaking of when we go up into the rapture, amen, to the wedding supper, then he makes himself known to his brethren. Amen. Then he makes himself known to the Jews. And he was also revealed in Moses as the lawgiver, you know. Jesus in Matthew 5, he would take the law. He says, you have heard of old time, you shall not commit adultery, but I say unto you. He magnified the law. Whosoever looks upon a woman to lust after her has committed adultery already. He magnified the law because he was the lawgiver. Amen. You follow me? He was the lawgiver. He was that same God. You know, we read in Malachi 3:1, it says, behold, I send my messenger before my face, and the angel of the covenant whom you delight in shall suddenly come to his temple. Who was that? That was now Jesus going down. He was the temple. Amen. It wasn't the building there that Herod expanded and did all those things. No. The temple was a body of flesh. Yeah. And he went down to the River Jordan. Amen. And that same God that led them out of Egypt into the promised land came and dwelt in his son. Amen. This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. That angel came. So the same God in the Old Testament is the same God in the New. And he is revealed in part all the way down through.
Yeah, that's true.
So God was rebuilding the man. And then now finally the masterpiece was upon the earth. Now, I'm talking about the man because I'm going to talk about you. Because he rebuilt the man. This is where I'm going to go to at the end. Just say, where are you going with this? And, you know, marriage and being united. You know, he was the man. But there has to be a woman. Amen? You following me? In the beginning, there was a man and a woman. It ends up in a garden. It ends up with a man and a woman in the garden again. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And so now, he was there. Now the fullness we just read, the fullness of God, he had bodily dwelt in him. He was the image of the invisible God. Now, in Jesus, everything we have need of is in God Himself. He is the source of all wisdom. He is the source of all healing. He is our Redeemer. He's our guide. He's the one who, you know, He's our shepherd. Everything we have need of is in Him. He is His Word. Amen. He's not just an imagination of a man in robes walking on the shores of Galilee. That was part of Him revealing Himself, but He's not back there in that way. Amen. But He's still His Word. Because it says now the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And that's not just now ink on paper becoming flesh. Even though you could say, well, it is that way. But that same being, that same pillar of fire that revealed Himself down through the Old Testament now became the fullness of all that now put on flesh. Yes. Hallelujah. Well, and so now, here He was. We read there Isaiah 53. And this was God describing His masterpiece man. Now to the natural eye, there was nothing that was what was special about Him. There was nothing great about Him. But yet here was the Creator had put on flesh. He hadn't just created a body like He did in Genesis 18, going down to Abraham to have a, you know, because he had a meal. You know, Abraham said to Sarah, you know, kill the fatted calf and do all these things. And He served the meal to them. Amen. And one of them was God in flesh.
That's right.
And so, but he couldn't be our Redeemer. Now, I think Brother Kydro mentioned this, but you got to understand, here's this God. And in Him is to be a healer. In Him is to be a Savior. In Him is to be a guide. In Him is to be a comforter. In Him is to be a healer. And, to be a lamb. To be a priest. To be an advocate. To be a king. All these things are in Him and many more attributes. But He can't display them without a wounding. He can't display them without sin. He can't display them without a fallen creation. He couldn't go to Adam before the fall and says, I'm your healer, Adam. Well, and here Adam would say, praise God, that's wonderful. But he wouldn't understand it. I'm your shepherd. He wouldn't need a shepherd in the garden. There's nothing to protect. There's no predators. You know, well, there were, but they weren't made that way. They didn't have that nature to kill and eat flesh.
Amen.
Then. So he didn't need a shepherd to guide him to green pasture or to protect him from some animal or something.
Right.
So he said, I'm your shepherd, Adam. Praise the Lord. That's wonderful. Thank you, Almighty God. He didn't know what it was.
Right.
I'm your Redeemer. What do you mean? I haven't fallen from anywhere. I'm placed exactly where you want me to be.
Right.
I'm standing in my position.
Amen.
Yeah. I'm your comforter. I don't even know what that means. That's what he'd say, because he's never needed to be comforted.
Right. Yeah.
He's never needed to be healed. He's never needed any of those things. So there's all this in God here, this great being. But he needed a wounding. He needed something to happen to him. Is this okay? You following me? He needed something to happen to him that he could release these virtues,
Amen.
Release these attributes. And so here's the fullness of God here, bodily in a man. Now, remember, we are under expectation for a body change.
Amen.
But that is only because God has a great expectation for you to change your bodies.
Amen.
There's a deep
Amen.
Calling to a deep.
Amen.
And if there's a hunger and thirst for more of God or to walk on the streets of gold, you know, the rapture is a revelation.
Amen.
Amen. And you can't be drawn to something unless it's been placed in front of you. Amen. How can you have a longing? You know, you can't have a longing to be saved unless it's put in front of you and then you're pulled to that thing. Amen. You're pulled to salvation. It has to be placed. Somehow God turns your heart, He turns your thinking. You say, yes, Lord, I have a need and you can meet my need.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So it's just like a rapture. You know, we don't want a rapture because the world's in that state. I trust you. Sure, God has allowed this world to be this way that we feel uncomfortable. Just like Israel had to feel uncomfortable in Egypt. Otherwise, they would never have left.
Right.
They had Goshen, the best part of the land. I'll give you a land flowing with milk and honey. I have a land flowing with milk and honey. So he had to make it uncomfortable for them. But I trust you don't want a rapture just because the world's in this state. But you want to go on streets of gold because there's something, you want to see Him. Face to face. You don't want to feel His presence and be anointed and be, you know, God come and do something for you. You want to stand in His presence, but see Him face to face. Amen. That there's not a limitation. These bodies limit our walk with God so much. Amen. In a way, because He's going to give us a new body. Hallelujah, that we won't be limited. You know, Brother Bram says the human body is not built to be in the presence of God. That's why you see, you know, you hear testimonies of His, you know, people. You know, he was in that other realm so much. And he saw visions continuously after meetings. They had to walk him around the block and drive him around to try and get him out of that state because he didn't know where he was anymore. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Jesus Himself. He said, before Abraham was, I am. You know, he's having that discourse with the scribes and Pharisees. And they said to Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he was glad. And they said to him, but you're not a man over 50 years old. How do you say you saw Abraham? So he was 30. But because his body was worn down by the anointing. Amen. Brother Bram said, you know, I'm a sinner, you know. It says in the scripture how the woman with the blood issue touched the hem of a garment. He says, virtue's left, strength is left from me. Right. He says, if that was the Son of God, how much a sinner saved by grace and see a few visions? And he said, it just tore him down. You see in the Deep Call of the Deep film, he like rubs his face like this. After the Lord's shown him someone's life in the prayer line, they go on. He rubs his face. He doesn't know really where he is. It's starting to tear him down. And so Jesus Himself looked older than He was. But here was God's masterpiece. Everything Israel needed was in Him. But He didn't come according to the way they thought He should come. And so, but the scripture had to be fulfilled. He had to be despised. He had to be rejected. He had to be acquainted with grief. But in Him, He was the masterpiece. Now, Brother Branham, when he saw Michelangelo's statue or the replica, he said what made it the masterpiece was the nick on the knee. Because Michelangelo, after he had finally, because it was one block of marble, and he chiseled, and he honed it, and he sanded it, and no doubt in his mind, we'd look at it and say, that looks pretty good, but he wouldn't be satisfied till finally the last little shavings, maybe a few millimeters here, and he looked at it, and he was so caught up, because what was in his mind was now material. They picked up his hammer, and he thought the only thing he could do was now speak because it was so alive to him. And he struck it on the knee, cried out, speak. And he was so inspired. He did that. He thought because now life would just come out. And he said now, Brother Bram said, that mark on the knee. And you can see it in the photo if you go Google it. The mark on the knee made it the masterpiece. Amen. Now, Jesus, the reason Jesus now was a masterpiece was the wounding. Was the wounding. He had to be wounded. Remember, there's all these virtues. Under the blood of bulls and goats, there was a partial atonement, you know, just covered sin. You know, there was some access to the believer to God. But God wasn't satisfied with that relationship. And I trust that many Israelites were not satisfied either. And so finally, here comes God's masterpiece. And he's fulfilling the word that's allotted to him. And then now, God looks down at his son, if I could say it that way, and he says, now what's been in my mind has become flesh and a man. And he stood the test against Satan. And he's endured criticism, endured all kinds of things, taken dominion over nature, cast out devils, raised the dead, called Lazarus back from the dead. All these, but now it was the season. Now the season changed. Amen. There was the healing campaigns in the beginning. Then there was the discernment. But now he said, I and my Father are one. Revealed who he really was.
Yeah, right.
And it made the religious people angry. How dare you say such things? How dare you make such claims?
Right.
You know, we love this prophet of Galilee, but now he's just gone overboard.
Right.
He's gone off the deep end. He's gone off the, you know, he went off the rails at the end. Who's heard phrases like that before?
Oh, yes.
And then so now here he was. And then, but now was this real season came. I mean, the real purpose, for this cause I've come into the world. Not just heal the sick, not just raise the dead and feed the people, but in me is eternal life. In me is redemption. In me is the purchasing price. In me is like Abraham when he bought the field for Sarah. He said, I want to know exactly the borders of this piece of land so there's no dispute. And I'm going to pay the full price. They wanted to give it to him. He said, no, I'm going to pay the full price.
Amen.
And so here comes the one, the only one,
Amen.
The only one who could do it.
Hallelujah.
And he puts his face towards Calvary. Here's the reason I'm coming. And he's walking towards Calvary because he knows I have the purchasing price. I'm going to pay it in full. There's going to be no interest on this claim. There's going to be no second payment. This is the payment.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And then now he goes on his way. Remember, there had to be a wounding. In him was everything. You know, I marvel sometimes. Never a man spake like this man. Never a man had really done the things that he did.
Amen.
No one had called a man rotting 4 days in the grave back to life.
Amen.
No one had done incredible things like that.
That's right.
He didn't look like much of a man, but he was God's masterpiece.
Amen.
And then so here he comes up Calvary. There had to be a wounding. Because remember, the joy that was set before him was you.
Amen.
That's why I went to the cross. He says, I have children. I have attributes that have fallen. I must restore them back to where they were.
Amen.
I must lift them up that where I am, they'll be. Hallelujah. And so here he is. Now, the great thing about the masterpiece was the wounding. You caused the wounding. Amen. But it's the great thing. It wasn't the healing of the thing. It was the wounding. And so he goes there in Pilate's judgment hall and begins the wounding.
Yep.
Hallelujah. By his stripes, we were healed.
Amen.
He knew it was in the word. He had to believe the scripture for himself.
Right.
He had to look into the word and say, I'm the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. John was exactly right when he said that on the River Jordan.
Hallelujah.
But Jesus had to believe it for himself as well.
Amen.
And then begins the wounding. And he wasn't. The joy that was set before him was, my children are going to be sick. There's sickness in the world. There's wounds that need to be made to release the healing out of
Amen.
Me.
Amen.
And then he went up Calvary, and they, you know, and he was hanging there, and the soldier pierced him in the side, and the blood and the water separated in his body and came out. Now that's a sign of a broken heart. He died of a broken heart.
Hallelujah.
But you got to understand, as Eve was in Adam, Eve came out of Adam,
Amen.
Both the body and the feminine spirit. Amen. And before the fall, they were still called Adam because they were walking in unison. She was only called Eve by Adam after the fall. You go read it.
Right.
And so now the material for Eve came out of Adam. And it's like the same thing. Remember, he's the fullness of the Godhead bodies. Everything God was poured into Christ.
Amen.
In the Old Testament, it was like, you say, I wish I had a picture, but it's like a three-sided prism. And you shine white light through it, and it makes a rainbow. All of that is the light that went through the prism, but it's not all the light. It's a part of it. That's why you can see in the Old Testament, you can see him in Moses, and David, and Solomon, and Jeremiah, and, you know, and Elijah, and all the different prophets, and Joseph, and all the shadows and types, because it was part of the light coming out. But now there was the fullness of it.
Amen.
Now Jesus said about the cup, communion cup. This is the New Testament in my blood.
Right.
Drink it as often as you remember me. So, you know, many times we just think, well, it's just a new covenant that's being shared. That's true. But if he is the word, and he's the fullness, remember the word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Everything this is, this is the revelation of Jesus Christ.
Yep.
Now, don't think you're doing mental gymnastics now, but so all of that now was in him. And if we are living epistles read and known of all men, we are in him.
Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
If we're part of him, he says this is the New Testament. So the writings of Paul were in him.
Amen.
Amen. The writings of, you know, all of Peter and all the New Testament, they were in him, but it had to be released.
Amen.
Because now a power was released through his wounding. That it wasn't just grace, as in, you know, as I said last Sunday, stooping down to someone who's inferior, but now it was a grace that was a divine influence upon the heart.
Amen.
So because the power was released, that's why the New Testament scribes or prophets could write about it. Because now they're actually telling the believer, this is what's happened to you, is that you've had a divine influence come upon you, that you could actually live the word.
Amen.
name.
Amen, that's it.
Hallelujah. Why? Because all of that was in him. Now, just as Eve was in Adam, so the bride was in Christ.
Yes.
Amen. And so when he was there, the water, what's the three things that happen when a baby's born? There's water, then there's blood, and then there's spirit. You know, normally you don't need to help them out. Sometimes you need to help them out. But they cry out, and then life comes in.
Amen.
Amen. And so he was there. There was the water, there was the blood, and Father, into thy hands do I commit my spirit.
Amen.
The spirit was released.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
So that's the reason, that's what made him the masterpiece, was the wounding, to get the life that was in him out into the people.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So you've really got to look at it. Remember, we have struggles. We feel sometimes like we're rapture ready, and sometimes we feel like we're never going to make the rapture. And sometimes we feel like we're on the mountain and in the valley and everything in between. Sometimes we feel we're so saved we could march down into hell. And he doesn't have any keys, but just roughen up a little bit. You know, maybe mash on him a little bit, then walk out. Then sometimes you see, oh God, how can we even survive the day? But you're looking at the wrong thing. You got to look at the wounding. Amen, because you caused the wounding. Because he knew that you're in a state. And he knew that I can't leave my children in that state.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I cannot leave them in that way.
That's right.
Amen. Now he says this. He says that great something in the sculptor, that vision he had of what Moses ought to be, was only portraying in type the great Father God. He had in his heart before the foundation of the world a son. Because he is a father, but it was still in the genes of his word, and he created a man. And he had to put him on free moral agency, but the man fell, but the great sculptor God, who made him from the dust of the earth, he didn't settle for that. He started again. He made a Noah, he died a drunk. He made a Moses that failed to keep his word. He made the prophets that run in the time of trouble. He kept building and molding until after a while he wanted a masterpiece to reflect him. His nature, what was in his heart, what a son should be. And then one day, down on Jordan, after that masterpiece had been formed and made, here he came sending down on wings of a dove. He said, this is him. He was so enthused with this masterpiece until he struck him on Calvary, and that he'd die for the rest of us wasn't perfect, that through the shedding of his blood he might bring many masterpieces, being a bride to his son. Masterpieces scarred because of the enthusiasm of God to see such a masterpiece. He struck him for us all, see? There he died to perfect we who are imperfect, the masterpiece. Oh my. Now we see him as the scripture said, God's masterpiece. We see him smitten, stricken, and afflicted of God. That's the real masterpiece, as Michelangelo struck his. That's what made. If he had just have lived a good life, he'd been like some of the people that preach the social gospel today. He was a prophet. He was a prophet, but he was more than a prophet. He was God. He was Emmanuel. And now what made him exactly? To me, the masterpiece to me and to you is because God smote him. He smote him at Calvary. Amen. If he hadn't been smitten, no matter how many dead he raised, how great he had preached, what great life was, what his claims was, it was proven there. He was so pleased God till he was the only man that ever stood on the face of the earth that God could smite for the rest of them. That perfect one was smitten for the imperfect. The whole creation that had fell through Adam, it was redeemed through Jesus Christ. God's masterpiece, he has stood the test. How did he do it? By the word. It's written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Oh, Christian friend, put on the whole armor of God. It's the word. The word is the armor of God. Amen. Don't stand back with some little idea of some creed or something that you're standing by. Put on the whole armor of God. When you go to fight against the enemy, like our Lord did, he showed that how the weakest of Christians can defeat Satan just with the word. He had powers. He could have smote Satan any way he wanted to, but he didn't use it. He just took the word and defeated him with it. It's written. It's everywhere it's written. So he defeated Satan by the word of God. Now, that was a perfect masterpiece. And God smote it. That was our example. What a real thing. Talk about Michelangelo's piece of sculpture over there by Moses being smitten on the leg. The Bible said this man was marred above all men. He was marred so much that he didn't even look like a son of man. He was beaten, he was bruised, he was bloody. He was striped. Everything that could be done. He looked like a big pile of blood and bones walking together. He didn't even look like a human being after he was drug up Calvary. God smote him for us. That's what made him the perfect masterpiece. Amen. God smote him. No, I was just pondering this so much last night. God smote him for us. That's what made him the perfect masterpiece. Because it says in Isaiah 53, we read there, yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. Hallelujah. Why did it please the Lord? It's because you needed it. Amen. Now the law had us all in jail. Amen. The law, that's why the law is impossible to live. And even the rich young ruler, as we call him, he ran to Jesus one day, good master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? He said, the law, honor thy father and mother, do all these things. He says, I've kept it all from my youth. But he knew something was missing. He did not have it. He was a good Christian. I'll put it in modern day language. He was a good Christian. He was devout to his church. He did all he could for the kingdom, he thought. But he was lacking one thing, eternal life. And that showed you cannot receive eternal life by the law, because the law just puts you in prison. And so now, but it had to be a man. The only way we could be free of the law is if a man came and set us free. Amen. Only a man could do it, because a man caused the fall in the beginning. And so a man had to undo the fall in the end. And so only a man could do it. But we're all born in prison. We're all born in sin, shaped in iniquity, come to the world speaking lies. Putting a few scriptures together. So there's no way that any of us could do it. Not one man can save another man. Not one man can redeem another man. Oh, this is very common. Now, I really want you to think about it. Remember, you caused the wounding. Hallelujah. And so grace... So the law was there, we're all condemned. But then grace came, and the virgin birth produced the product.
Amen.
Amen. That undid the curse of the law. Hallelujah. We should be the happiest people in all the world. Amen. Grace came. He was full of grace. It said he was the fullness of grace. Amen. And then so he came. And the reason he came, you say, well, I've heard the story of the cross. We're all in chains, friends. He's full of grace, and it was a transfer. He was the sacrifice. And through his wounding, that grace that was in him to live the word. Amen. It's not about singing and shouting and jumping and doing religious things. It's to live the word. Amen. It's to embody this word. And no man can do it in their own strength, because we're all in a fallen condition. No one can be. I say it probably every Sunday, but you cannot be a Christian in your own strength. Amen. People wrestle against things and say, what about this? What about this? If your heart is really turned to God, you'll believe his word.
Amen.
Amen. You'll not take a creed. A creed didn't die for you.
Amen.
This church didn't die for you.
Yeah.
The word was hung on Calvary.
Amen.
The word was your sacrifice.
Amen.
The word stood in your place.
Amen.
He took your judgment.
Amen.
Shekinah Tabernacle didn't take your judgment. He didn't die for you. The word died for you.
Amen.
And then that's why Brother Ramsey stood there. And he said, did your denomination die for you? He said, no. But people say, I'd rather take my creed, my denomination, above the word of God. He says, well, did the denomination die for you? No. The word died for you on Calvary. He is his word. That's why we should always say, Lord, what does your word say about me? And if what I do is contrary to your word, give me the grace that I change my thinking. I was praying last night. I said, It just so struck me. We pray and we say, Lord, do this, and Lord, do this, and Lord, do this, and Lord, help this person, Lord, do this. We should do those things. But he's not our errand boy.
That's right.
Prayer should change our thinking that it matches his thinking.
Amen.
Amen. Because many people, they run off and do. The scribes and Pharisees were running off and doing what they thought was good. Paul had his ideas. I'm going to crush this thing. Because he was zealous for the what he thought was the truth.
Yeah. Right.
And when he was praying, saying, Lord, help me get these Christians. Help me get this sect and snuff it out wherever I find it. Open the door, Lord, to do it. Then he goes to the high priest. The high priest says, I'll give you letters. Thank you, Lord, for answered prayer. God's behind me. God wasn't behind him. He was kicking against the pricks.
That's right.
Amen. He should have really been, Lord, change my thinking.
That's right.
Is my thinking skew? Israel's thinking went real skew.
That's right.
Amen. They said, oh, we want to do what we want to do. No, prayer ultimately changed this thing.
Yes.
Amen. If we have the mind, if I have the mind of Christ, I do not have my own thinking.
Right.
Hallelujah. Because two wills cannot operate in the same body. It's either your will, which is a carnal, natural will, or it's God's will.
Amen.
Amen. You say, well, how do I? Remember, Jesus came into the world not to do his own will. He didn't come into the world saying, now this is what I want to do.
That's right.
Even when he said, the doctrine I speak is not my own. It's his that sent me.
That's right.
You know, and he was led, as it says in John, I think 4 or 5, you know, he goes to the pool of Bethesda. He heals one man, whole bunch of people there. He says the son can do nothing till the father shows him.
Yeah.
And that which the father shows him, he does likewise. He was led by vision.
Yes.
He was a sheep. A sheep are led.
That's right.
Amen. He was a sheep. He was a sheep given. He was a sacrificial lamb. Sheep always led.
Yep.
So here he was being led. This was now, he had to become a prisoner. We all say, well, he was God made flesh. He was an example for you. Amen. And he was now a gift. He was a life that was poured out.
Yeah.
I'm going to make a transition down into your address very soon, but you know, in the Old Testament, there was the drink offering. And it was poured out. Amen. And his life, like David, he's sitting there away from Bethlehem. Bethlehem means house of God's bread, we know. And so he's sitting there up in the hills, wherever he is. He says, oh, if I could just taste the waters of the well of Bethlehem. And his soldiers, three of them, you know, that was just a desire of David, but he changed. They took a smallest desire of David and made it a commandment.
Yep.
And Brother Abraham said the Christian should be the same way. The smallest desire of God should be like a commandment. And they chopped their way down through the Philistines,
amen,
grabbed the water, bring it back.
Amen.
And then he said, my soldiers put their lives in jeopardy for this. And he couldn't accept it, and he just, because of that, and he just poured it out upon the earth, speaking about what was going to happen to the son of David. There is a fountain. There'll be a fountain open in the house of David. Hallelujah. It says in the scripture, that fountain has been opened to you.
Yes.
Amen. But in order for the fountain to be opened, there had to be a wounding. There had to be a life poured out.
Hallelujah.
And when he was on Calvary, his blood bathed the earth because he was that drink. Remember, all the sacrifice in the Old Testament were a shadow of the new. So here was in the Old Testament just a drink offering, and now here he was on Calvary. And his blood was poured out upon the earth as an offering. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
His life was poured out. He wasn't led by his own will. Remember, he was a man, so he had his own will. He was a man. He was built like you and I, but he wasn't born like us, because he was created in Mary. Amen. So he wasn't born with a sin nature, but he was still born like you and I. He had a will. He was a man like us. But he surrendered his will. It wasn't his will operating. It was God's will. If I can put it that way. And he was showing that. That was all done. Because now, here is you. And the question is put in front of all humanity. Are you willing to let your will die? Here was the image, you know, Jesus, you know, it always strikes me. They come and test him. Should we pay tax to Caesar? And he says, here's the coin. You know, he says, now whose inscription is on this coin? And it was the image of Caesar. Here was the image of the invisible God. The church was so carnal, they knew what a coin was and whose image was on the coin. But they didn't see God in flesh. They missed the real image standing in front of them. And they were so. And he said, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, the things that are God, that's which is God's. But here was the image. And his life was lived in such a way. Now, that was the man. We are the woman. the bride of Christ is the second Eve. Okay? So if the man was like that, because husband and wife are one. So ultimately, the same life is lived, but one's masculine and one's feminine. Because they become one flesh. So if the man was like that, then how much more the woman? Amen? How do you know you're redeemed? You no longer want your own will.
That's right.
It's not all the religious things you go through, and I went to this school, and I learned this, and I read this book, and I know this back to front. You got to know the author.
Amen.
If you don't know the author, you're just like the you're just like the scribes and Pharisees. Paul was a Pharisee of the Pharisees. But he said, I count it all but dung.
Amen.
That I may win Christ.
Amen.
He said, cast down your reasoning.
Yes.
Amen. He knew what it was like to cast down his reasoning, to count it all but dung. It didn't mean he forgot all the scripture. He just laid aside his interpretation.
That's right.
Because he began to recognize now, my interpretation is not really who God is.
Right.
And then Paul would say many times, Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ. Amen. He was a prisoner. He laid his will down that even though he knew that he was going to go to Jerusalem and be bound and all those things that happened to him, he said, praise the Lord, this is God's will. And he said, whatever state you find yourself in, be content, that's the will of God for your life. So he said, you have to become a love prisoner. Remember, there'll be many, it says in Matthew 7, many will come to me in that day saying, Lord, Lord, have I not cast out devils? Spoken tongues, done many wonderful things in your name. And the Lord didn't, it never says in Matthew 7 that he denies him. I mean, the Lord denies what they did. He says, depart from me, ye that work iniquity. I never knew you. I never became one with you.
Yeah.
Well, how could that be? People are anointed. Miracles happen. Wonderful things happen. But they are counted as workers of iniquity.
Yeah.
Why? Because their will.
Yeah.
Their will is operating instead of God's will. Say, well, Jesus was surrendered to the word that was allotted to him. How much you and I? Now, I just want to kind of turn a bit of a corner. Now, let's go to Colossians again, chapter 3. Everyone happy today?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Colossians 3:15. Now the body of Christ is called to edify one another in love.
Yeah.
But the only way that can be done is when grace is imparted. You cannot spiritually help someone if grace is not imparted. You can be religious, you can quote things, you can do all those, you know, you can pray for people, but it's when grace is imparted. Because remember, it's all, now, the life comes from the man, and then it's manifested in the woman. And so now, since that is true naturally, that's very true spiritually. So if there's not life that has come from the man, you know, Brother Bram says, you know, you can get it's a crude expression, but it came to mind. It's like you get a nest of rotten eggs. It's because the hen hasn't been with the, you know, with the male bird.
Yeah.
It's just a nest of rotten eggs.
Yeah.
There's eggs, but they haven't hatched. There's not life.
Yeah.
He says the hen needs to be with the mate,
yeah,
and then it'll produce the life that was in the mate,
that's right,
in the rooster. And so now the real life. He says this here, and let peace, so this is Colossians 3:15. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful. So important to be thankful. I mean, there's a lot, you know, I was reading it last night, a lot of places where Paul says about thankfulness and being thankful.
Amen. That's right.
Because if you're not thankful, you know, you just actually begin to actually find Christianity to be a drudgery. You should be thankful in every situation.
Amen.
And if you're in a trial, you should say, God, what do you want to teach me in this trial?
That's
Because many things happen in life and you may never go down that road again. It may only ever happen once. So you've got to really look at something and say, Lord, what are you showing me in this trial? And you should be thankful. And you should... Jesus went the most rugged way. His life was a life of sorrow, grief, and agony. But it was the most rugged way because his name would be high above all else. It was actually... His walk was a privilege. And every path we go down, you should count it as a privilege. That God is so wanting to mold and shape a character in you. You say, thank you, Lord. Remember, find it not, you know, think it not strange when you, you know, suffer trials and all those, you know, Peter says. Think it not strange. And because, you know, but if you're not thankful, we should always be thankful. You know, you see some people, they become a believer and they're full of zeal and then they burn out. What happens? They've left some place that they were once in.
Yep.
Now, it doesn't mean, you know, you can be a wildfire, but a refined fire is just as good.
Yep.
Amen? As long as there's a life there.
Yep.
You know, if it just becomes common, oh, I have eternal life. I've been redeemed. If that just becomes a common thing, well, you need to really go back to your first love. Doesn't mean life doesn't get hard. You know, but we should always be thankful.
Amen.
Let the word of God dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Now that's grace, imparted grace. Amen. So the whole way of actually being a believer is actually grace is imparted to you. Amen. It doesn't just become a thing up here, but you know the grace of God has come upon your life.
Yeah.
And then when that mainspring comes in, just like Brother Brandon speaks about the watch, the Holy Ghost comes in, that mainspring comes in, all the rest of all the mechanics that you have will begin to tick away just how it should be.
Yeah. Amen.
And whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by Him. So he says now, this is how we should be. If divine love has been imparted to you, you can give it to others.
Yeah.
Amen. If the life of God has been imparted to you, you can impart eternal life to others.
Right.
The apostles did it. While yet Peter spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell upon them. What happened? God used a vessel to impart eternal life.
Right.
Jesus was full of grace and truth. But that grace and truth had to come into the believer. Amen. It had to come and dwell in you. I trust this is not laborious this morning. I want you to think about these things. Now it says in Ephesians 4 that the body edifies itself in love. So if love is imparted, if grace is imparted, then you can impart it to someone else. Because there's a life in you. It's like in the book of Revelation. It speaks in two places of the Lamb's wife. Doesn't say about like the, you know, a wife is very different to a girlfriend or just someone you meet on the street. Because a wife is the only legal one that can actually produce the life that's in the spouse, in the husband. So it's very different. You say, well, how is that with me? People can be anointed on their spirits or in their flesh. And they can have incredible things happen. But that's not the life being produced. It's when God goes into the soul. And then you can actually, remember, because, you know, when a baby's born, especially the firstborn one, you can look at it and you can see the father, this child looks like me. Here's my clone. I have one. Why? Because what I look like is now in my children. And so the wife can leap, because like a girlfriend or a fiance, they can get all these gifts. Amen, brothers.
Amen.
But then when you get married, you still give the gifts. Amen.
Amen.
But there's now life that can be legally be produced.
That's right.
And so the wife has something. They can have gifts, but she can say, look at the baby.
Yeah.
It's made in the father's image.
Yeah.
Made in my husband's image. So there's a life that's being produced.
Yeah. Right.
Hallelujah.
Amen. That's right.
And that is the difference between a real believer a real believer that surrendered their will, and a flirter who just wants the gifts and the trinkets.
Yeah, right.
Amen. Because we don't want to be flirters.
No.
What is a flirter? They enter into a relationship for their own good.
Yeah.
What can I get? You see women that that go after rich men. They're flirters. What can I get out of this rich man? Jesus, the richest man in all the earth. He made all things. And so we do not want to treat God as what can we get out of him, which is very much the modern thinking of the day. It's not what you can do for God, it's what God can do for you.
Right.
Amen. That's what we can do for him. Because we have a portion of the scripture to live out. Amen. But you cannot live out your portion of the word if it's your wills operating. Brother Aaron makes a statement, and to me it's more than a statement. He said, if Michelangelo dwelt in me, I would do, if the spirit of Michelangelo was in me, I'd do great masterpieces. He says, if the spirit of John Dillinger was in me, who was a gangster, I would shoot with guns and do all those things. But he says, if the life of Jesus Christ is in me, I will do the works of Jesus Christ. Because it's no longer me alive anymore, I'm dead. But he is now come and dwell in me. Hallelujah. And that is the wife of God.
Amen.
It's no longer her living. Paul said, it's no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. And people take that scripture, they put it somewhere, and they say, yes, amen, they do what they want.
Yeah, true.
That's a religious spirit, it's a lie.
Amen. That's right.
Amen. We don't want to do that. We don't want to be flirted to say, Lord, you come in that day, Lord, have I not done all these wonderful things? Do you know why they do that? Do you know why that Matthew 7 is that way? Because they come up before the great white throne judgment, they try and plead their case. We've done these things. Surely it's good enough evidence that I can get in. He says, you're workers of iniquity. I never knew you. You received gifts. You did, but you did what you wanted to do. And I never knew. I never became one with you. Hallelujah. But the bride does not go to the great white throne judgment.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen. Do you think God will send his wife through the great tribulation to purge her? Remember, the Great Tribulation is a purging of nature. It's a purging of humanity.
Yeah.
But why if he took all the judgment on Calvary, why would he send you through that?
Right. Amen.
Hallelujah. There's no more purging.
Amen.
For the bride of Christ.
That's right.
Hallelujah. Now, so we are, Jesus' life, I'm just going to finish with this. His life was poured out for the people. He was a gift poured out. How much more now the bride? Now, we don't have to die on a cross for redemption. But there's a life that's to be poured out.
Amen.
And it's not about being, it's not your life being poured out, it's his life being poured out.
Yes.
Jesus was the rose of Sharon, the lily of the valley. What they do to get the perfume out of those, the rose of Sharon, it was crushed. It was crushed to get the fragrance out. His life was crushed on Calvary, that a fragrance would come out of it. Hallelujah. Amen. How do they get, like cold-pressed olive oil? You've got to be a pressing going on.
Amen.
To get the oil out, and the harder you press, the finer the oil. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, if that's the man, what about the woman?
Amen.
Amen. Sometimes we think, why am I going through such terrible things? There's a pressing.
Amen.
There's a crushing going on. Because the life that was in him is in you.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Because there has to be a release. There has to be a release of what's in you.
Oh.
Amen. Jesus said, and I've said it a few times, but they came and saw the temple and the disciples say, what manner of stones are here? He said, destroy this temple to the scribes and Pharisees, and 3 days I'll raise it up again. And that word destroy means loose. Loose me from this temple. He didn't just want to be there in a body. He wanted to be in his people.
Amen.
He wanted to dwell in his people.
Amen.
Loose me from this prison, he was basically saying. So there had to be a crushing. There had to be a wounding that he was released.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And here we are. Remember, you have a seed of God in you from the foundation of the world. God doesn't run his business in a haphazard way. He doesn't really seal someone into the kingdom just to unseal them and to loose them. Lose them. The reason people go back into the world is because they're never sealed in.
Amen.
They never fully surrendered their will and God transformed their life. And so, if there's a seed in you and then he anoints that seed, it begins to grow.
Amen.
But it means now there's a life there that has to be squeezed out.
Yeah.
Amen. Because if there's a squeezing, look at David. Do you think we would have the book of Psalms if he just went straight from being Saul's right-hand man? Saul says, okay, sure, I'm not king anymore. Here you go, David. You would never have got the book of Psalms. But there was a squeezing. There was a crushing. Because there were these songs and great sorrow and peril and all these things that were within him. But they had to be released.
Amen.
That, you know, that life that was in him had to be expressed, and it could never have been expressed if he just went straight to the throne.
That's right.
Hallelujah. How much more? Remember, it's not your life that's being expressed in great trial, it's his life.
That's right.
Amen. It's not you being pressed out, it's God. The oil's coming out. The fragrance is coming out.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh, I'm glad about that. Many times we're never glad about that. But God is pressing. He was a man acquainted with grief and sorrow and agony. And we go through these things. But you have to remember, the reason we go through those things is because he's molding and shaping us because we're part of his masterpiece. Brother Bram says that he said to be a king or to be in charge of things without character is satanic. But to have character and be on the throne is fit to rule. Amen. And that's why many people, they get placed into, you know, you just look in the world, they get placed into things of leadership, but they don't have the character to bear the responsibility. Amen. Why are we molded and shaped and go through ups and downs and lefts and rights and all kinds of hard things? Because he's molding and shaping our character. Because one day we're going to rule and reign with him.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Now, I just want to go back to Isaiah 53 again. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. We all fit in that verse. Why does a sheep go its own way? It thinks it has a better idea. Have you ever, me and my brother on my great uncle's station up between the back road between Gisborne and Wairoa, we had a four-wheeler. He's like, hey, take these 500 sheep down into this pen. We're about 10. You see sheep, they try and go off, you know, this is just down the road. You know, then the sheep go off here. You got to, you know, keep corralling them down the road. It's because those ones think they have a better idea. But why would you go walk in a ditch and eat some old grass when there's a field awaiting you where there's way better grass there? It's because the sheep thinks this is the best way to go. But you need a shepherd to come in behind to guide and say, no, this is not here, up in the paddock. But if that sheep has its own will, it'll never just enjoy the walk. You know, it'll fight, it'll try all kinds of things. But eventually that sheep has to yield itself. You get problem sheep, but as long as you're a sheep. You can't make yourself a sheep. You're born a sheep.
Amen. That's right.
Amen. Let's just have some musicians come, actually. That's okay. So your will, you say, well, why are you saying all these things? You got to understand. You caused the wounding. Because God knew that you needed help. Amen. There was things in him. Why is there hardship? You know, I think as Brother Kydra said, Satan released God upon the people. By bringing sin in, all those attributes that were in God could now be released. To be a sacrifice, to be a redeemer, to be a guide, to be a priest, and all those different things. They were never revealed to Adam until after the fall. And it was actually Satan actually helped God reveal himself to the people. He didn't think that was the plan. He said, I'm just going to separate them and then I'm just going to do what I want on the earth. But he released God to the people. The scribes and Pharisees, who caused the resurrection? Judas. All of the scribes and Pharisees, they plotted. How are we going to destroy this man? Here comes one from the inner circle. Here it comes. I can show you where he is. You can take him in quiet. What will you give me? He did it. He was the vehicle that God allowed to come to cause the resurrection. Here we are. We live in a very interesting time. We live in a time where Brother Bram talked about a squeeze. We live in that time. Oh, when the squeeze happens, then this will happen. We're already beginning. You know, have you ever used a device to squeeze something and squeeze something? You know, like a vice. You don't just do one turn and it's there. You turn it slowly. Make sure your bit of water there is in place. You keep it level, everything fine. The face you want to work on, you have it all right. Slowly, slowly, slowly. Now we're done. That's the same thing. Like the Jews. They didn't wake up one morning. They're in Europe. Everything's fine. The next morning, they're in Auschwitz. Just squeeze. Squeeze, 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 squeeze. You know, pressure. There's riots. They're bullied, beaten, put on the stars, put into ghettos, all these things. There's a squeeze coming on. They found themselves in an Auschwitz or a, you know, whatever concentration camp. And we have to realize, you say, oh, when the squeeze happens, then the power, the fullness of spoken word will be here and all these different things. We live in the time of the squeeze.
Yep.
Amen. What was done against the Jews naturally, spiritually will be done against the bride.
Yep.
And it's the World Council of Church and the denomination which will squeeze the bride.
Yep.
But then Brother Brand says, when that all happens, it's only to squeeze us up.
Amen.
Not to crush us down.
Amen.
Amen. So, and you say, well, why is there a squeezing? It's because there's a life in you that needs squeezed. Do you think we'd actually want to go to heaven if we... Why does Satan make this world like this? It's all comfortable, you know. It doesn't matter if, you know, you just go to the government, I need help. And those things are there, those things are fine. But, you know, we have everything laid on. Why? Because the devil wants to make you comfortable in this world. Doesn't want to make you press in and cry out. You know, Moses' parents, they saw it was nearly time for the deliverer to come. They were slaves in Egypt. They would have been praying. Lord, you said through Abraham we were going to go to our promised land. We're being afflicted. When are we going to leave the land? You know, Brother Bram dramatized it. He said, you know, and then his wife says to, you know, to the husband, are you going to go up there and pray after you've been beaten all day? He says, someone's got to pray.
Amen.
And then God came upon the scene. You're going to have the promised son.
Amen.
You're going to have the deliverer.
Amen.
Why? Because he was not satisfied with just being a slave.
Amen.
He was not satisfied with just living in the world he was living in.
Amen.
What about you and I?
Amen.
There's a rapture to have.
Amen.
I mean, there's a world to leave and an eternal one to go to. And you say, well, why am I being squeezed? And there's the busyness of life and it's so hard. You find it so hard to find time to do really what you want to do. It's a squeeze. It's a pressure, but use the pressure for your good. Don't use it because you can either look at it as a bad thing. I'm never going to get. Oh, I just can't find the time to read and pray and do whatever more. Or you can rejoice and say, "Thank you, Lord, I'm squeezed."
Amen.
Because if I was comfortable here, you know, the Egyptians were pretty comfortable because they weren't squeezed until the plagues came. There's a different season. Amen. It's like us. You know, we can sit back and say, no, it's all fine, not worried, we're good. Well, don't be in that state. Because if you're in that state, why is God squeezing us? Because he allows it to be uncomfortable because there's a land to go to.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. So Canada's a good thing. We live in perilous times. Praise the Lord. We live in a change where time is blending out and eternity's coming in. Praise the Lord. This world's falling apart. Praise the Lord. Amen. You know, we shouldn't be worried about these things. Brother Ram said you just can't lose being a Christian.
Amen.
And when he said that, it was just after they were driving somewhere. His suitcase with all his worldly possessions on the road fell off the car. They lost it. And then one of them wanted to buy him suits and all these things. And he says, don't worry about it. This guy calls up. You know, is Brother Bram there? Yes, he's here. Well, I'm on my way. I found his suitcase. And you know, all the brothers with him were all worried about it. He said, no, don't worry about it. And he says, you just can't lose being a Christian.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Let's just stand, shall we? Amen. Let's just go to number 7. I'm amazed that you love me. Amen. Let's go to the chorus first. Oh, here we are. Good.
I'm amazed that you love me. I'm amazed how you care. Through your precious blood, I found pardon. All my sins are washed, they're all washed away. All my sins are washed. Thank you.
Amen. Let's go to number 9. He paid a debt he did not owe.
Amen.
Amen. He paid a debt he did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. I needed someone to wash all my sins away. My enemy's dead.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I trust when you sing these songs, you have that revelation. My sins are gone.
Amen.
Everything held against me is dead in the sea. Washed in the sea, his forgiveness by his blood. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen. I'm just so glad to be a believer. Hallelujah. Hey. Amen. Let's go to number 31. We're looking for a city.
Oh, yes, we're looking for
amen.
A city.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Here among the shadows living in a lonely land, the strangers hear a band of pilgrims on the
moon.
Behold you, you're our masterpiece, Lord. Lord, you're so perfect and so wonderful. Lord, you're altogether lovely. Lord, how great you are.
Hallelujah.
Father, we're so glad, Lord, that you came.
Yes, Jesus,
Lord, you hung between heavens and earth on a cross.
Hallelujah.
Lord, to release everything was in you to us, Lord. Lord, redemption, salvation.
Hallelujah.
Father, comfort, Lord, healing. Lord, you arose with healing in your wings.
Amen.
We're so thankful for that, Lord, and we just want to praise your holy name that, Lord, you have risen with healing in your wings, Lord, in the end time as well.
Hallelujah.
Father, you haven't left us lost and undone. But, Lord, you've come to claim your bride in this hour. We praise your holy name for it, dear God. Father, may, Lord, may our will, may it never be alive. May it only be your will. Lord, may we just, Lord, always be a yielded vessel in your hands. Father, may you grant it for your glory. Lord, you are our example. Father, you are just the meek and lowly man from Galilee. But Lord, you are the creator of heavens and earth. But Lord, I pray you would help us always to be yielded, Lord, to your care. Father, wherever you'd guide us, Lord, may we rejoice and count it a privilege.
Yes, Father.
Lord, because in your great mind, Lord, you thought of our walk upon the earth.
Yes,
Lord, and you planned it, Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And Lord, we thank you, Lord, every step of the way. Lord, you've ordered our steps.
Hallelujah.
We thank you for that, O God. May we just count it all joy. Father, wherever we go in life. Father, Lord, through great valleys, down great valleys, or over high mountains, through fire, through floods, whatever it is, Lord. May we always just rejoice.
Amen.
And just be so thankful
that
you're our shepherd. And Lord, you have a destination that you're leading us to. Be so thankful it's not the trial, it's through the trial. Lord, it's not to the valley, it's through the valley, O
God.
Father, just help us, Lord. Always, may we always be sensitive to your voice.
Yes, Father.
Lord, because your sheep know your voice and a stranger they'll not follow. thank you for that, Almighty God.
Yes, Father.
Lord, may you just dismiss us with your blessing now.
Hallelujah.
Lord, take all these very chopped up words, Lord, and put them together how you want by your Holy Spirit, Lord. May you grant it, I pray, Lord. Bless each one in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you, friends. You're dismissed in Jesus Christ's name.
There's a land that we shall meet on that.